So you got arrested by the police, Lo? They had a gun on you? How old are you? Oh, you look a lot younger. But still, 17 is still, yeah. Mm-hmm. God bless you. I'm glad you're here to tell your story. And, you know, that's what I was saying. I'm really glad that we're doing this because people need to hear it. They need to know that it really does happen. And it happens to good people who, you know, so my story started in April of 2003, I'm sorry. And our son, I'm married. My husband and I just celebrated 38 years. A marriage, and so our son called us one April, and he said, "I've been arrested." And I'm like, "Stop joking! You know, it's not funny. Where are you at?" You know, and he had been arrested. And so what happened was, he was a senior in high school. He went to Rockbridge High School, and by the way, my name is Dee Campbell-Carter. Didn't say that. And I've been in Columbia for almost 40 years. It'll be 40 years in September. And my husband was born and raised here in Columbia. His name is Gary Carter. And we, you know, have raised our own three biological children. And then we've also been foster parents of, you know, and graduated additional three other kids from our home. And so we, you know, I'm a social worker, have been for, retired after 25 years. And now I'm a teacher, and this is my seventh year as a teacher. And so, you know, we feel like we're middle class, upstanding, involved, participatory citizens in Columbia. And so at the time that all this happened in April of 2003, I was serving on the Human Rights Commission. I was a volunteer and serving on the City of Columbia's Human Rights Commission. And at that time, there was some discussion about the fact that several people had filed charges against the City of Columbia because of the way that the police were treating them. And so we, as human rights commissioners, felt like it was important to provide some oversight to the police. You know, maybe we tried to have conversation with them, brought in Chief Frank Baim at the time was the police chief. And so we brought him in and talked to him about our concerns that this is becoming, you know, a lot more often that you are arresting people of color and that they're coming to, you know, give some concerns. So they're filing charges against you. And so he was like, no big deal. And it's okay. And this is just what we have to do, you know, and it's a college town. And sometimes negative elements do come in. And, you know, so we're like, okay, well, what we would like to recommend. And there was again, the Human Rights Commission had no teeth, really. But we recommended that there be an advisory board to oversee the police department's arrest record, and that advisory board would make suggestions, because that's really all we could do, about how they could handle things differently. And at the time, my husband and I had started an organization called Community Link. And in Community Link, we were doing, we were having professional development seminars for the City of Columbia, for the University of Missouri Columbia, for Columbia Public Schools. And so we had gathered these inner city families who we knew personally. They lived in our neighborhood. They, you know, participated in different kinds of organizations to help, like the PTA, and, you know, they would go to school board meetings and things like that. And so we gathered together people who already had been involved in some kind of way. And Community Link would put on these professional development seminars for these different organizations. And so we suggested, the Human Rights Commission suggested that the City of Columbia's Police Department work with Community Link free of charge. We were willing to, you know, provide you with this so that we could better learn how to communicate with people of color. That was our premise. That was our goal. And so parents of color, because we wanted to impact the children. And so we did that for probably a year. And so all this was kind of going on, you know, when in April of 2003, our son called and said, "I've been arrested." And so we were kind of pushing the agenda a bit, you know, really asking the police department to work with us to try to address these issues and here we have this organization provided for you free of charge to do it. So it was really within their best interest to agree, you know, even though obviously there was some concern, you know, about, and it's still going on that where they, you know, don't want to have the advisory board. But anyway, that was when it first started. That was the initial introduction of that. And so when our son called and said, I've been arrested, we thought clearly there's been a mistake. This is, you know, a son that is very introverted, really does not care to be out and about and doing things with, you know, his friends. He was not part of the in crowd. And so when they were like, so we were like, what have you been arrested for? Possession of cocaine, crack cocaine. Not this one. You know, and I'll say never for my children, ever. You know, like I said, we raised six kids, so I'm clear that you never say never. But with that son, we knew never. He would not have crack cocaine, you know. He would not have a cigarette. You know, we were clear. He's that kind of person. And so he was 17. He had just that morning, it was Saturday evening, he had just that morning taken the SAT. He had gotten a scholarship. And so he, with the potential to go to school if he passed the SAT. So he had been studying, you know, for this SAT and just really digging deep and making sure that he did well on SAT. And so he took the SAT and then he went to work, and then on his way home from work, one of his friends, her child was sick. So he went, picked her up from wherever they had taken the child, maybe emergency care or something like that, and brought her home. So he was in the inner city neighborhood where we don't live, but he was in there to bring one of our friends home. And so he had picked her up at this urgent care and brought her and her baby back too. And they lived on like 5th Street or 4th Street, something like that. And was on his way home. So it was like 10:30 at night. And like I said, usually he don't stay up that late. So I was calling like, where are you at? You know, and he didn't respond. And so that's when, you know, I started calling. And I probably called his phone, you know, 20 times. Like, where are you at? What are you doing? You know, at least let me know. So finally he called us back and he said, I've been arrested. And that's when we were like, what? You know, so long story short, he was coming down Wilkes Boulevard and he made a turn on Washington. And that's when they pulled him over on the corner of Washington and Wilkes Boulevard. I don't know if you're all aware, that's inner city Columbia. And that's where a lot of low income families live in that area, kind of close to.
Very close to Hickman.
Yes, very close to Hickman. Mm-hmm, so that's where we were. And we live kind of over near the mall, like right on the outskirts of, we are in the first ward, but we're on the very outskirts, like Clinkskills over there. So he was bringing himself home and they pulled him over. And he said, they asked him, could we search your car? And he was like, sure, you know, I don't have nothing to hide. And so they put him in the back of the police car with his hands cuffed while they searched his car that he had given them permission to search. And so when they didn't find anything in his car, then they, you know, uncuffed him and no apology, you know, they're just, okay, you can go. So he was like, cool, you know. So he was sitting in his car texting me because I have been calling him every 15 seconds, you know, and he was texting me, I'm on my way, you know. And that's when they said, stop the car, your hands, because he had started his car and then he started texting me and or maybe calling me, I don't remember. But anyway, they turned the lights back on and got out of the car. They had their guns drawn and he was like, you know, well, I thought you said I could go, you know. His car was in, stop the car. And so they put him down on the ground and told him, is this yours? And he was looking up at them like, what is wrong? So anyway, they yanked him up again. By then his hands are behind his back and they said that they had found crack cocaine in the back of the police car, and because he had been in there, it was his, because, you know, we sweep the car after every arrest very thoroughly, right? So he was like, and so they're handing it to him. See, and this is how they act, you know. This, I was like, really? Oh my God, you know, because I'm very naive, very trusting. I want to believe that all things work together, you know. So yes. And so they handed it to him and said, you know, is this yours? And he's like, what is it? I mean, he didn't touch it. Thank you, Lord. Because otherwise they would have had his fingerprint on it. So he's like, what? He didn't even know what it was. You know, he said, what is it? I'm like, you know what it is. It's yours. Go ahead and admit it's yours. And he was like, I don't even know what that is. And no, it's not mine. So they put him back in the police car did not, you know, he still has not called me. He was trying to call me when they impounded his car, took him to the Boone County Police Department, way, way out in Prathersville.
The county jail.
Yes, they took him, and he was 17. He was 17. So, you know, he calls us, and we're like, ooh. And so, you know, you think about, I don't know, or you have children. That's your child. And he's kind of introverted, easygoing, peaceful, loving. Yeah, but now I'm going to be under the jail if something happens to my son while he's in you all, while you try to figure this out. So first they said they could not release him for the night, and he was going to have to be in there overnight. And we're like, no, we have money. We will come and get him. No, you can't get him. They set his bond at $1 million.
Oh, my God.
Thank you. I'm like, you don't have. So anyway, we called our lawyer because we do have friends who are lawyers. So we call a person. So once they called the lawyer called them. Then they were like, okay, it's $10,000. So we had to put up $1,000. Thankfully, we had it. You know, thankfully, I'm thankful. But so that was like, okay, let's just, you know, figure it out. And so our lawyer was in a different area. And so we had to get a lawyer that was for criminal, you know. So we did, and it was very, you know, it cost us an arm and a leg. Really what we ended up doing was refinancing our house, and we used that money. Thankfully we had a house. Oh, you know, some people don't own property, so they cannot do that, you know, and that means your child is, or whoever it is, you know, in trouble because, so we refinanced our house and we paid, you know, a significant amount of money to keep saying, so every month our attorney would contact them and they would be like, well, we're reducing the charges to possession of marijuana. Well, no marijuana around. Why would you even say that? You know, okay, we're reducing the charges to possession of paraphernalia. There was no paraphernalia around. No, we're not gonna agree to that either. Well, we're reducing the charges to resisting arrest. There was, again, what? No. And thankfully, like I said, Zim, who was a police officer at the time in Columbia and a good friend of mine because we had worked together in the school system, said, don't admit to anything. If they, you know, my friends came through for us. I'm so thankful. Our family, they helped us financially, you know, pay for the lawyer so that we would not have to refinance again, you know, because it was a lot. So anyway,
basically the city wanted to just keep, they wanted to do some plea deal.
Exactly.
He didn't do.
Exactly.
Cover, which a lot of people do.
Exactly. If you don't have the resource to continue to say no, and they won't talk to you, they talk to the attorney. They will not even, you know, they won't even discuss it with you. Where's your attorney? And so we have to keep paying this attorney. And thankfully the attorney was on the up and up, but it was expensive, you know? And so the attorney finally, there was an issue too with, we knew an African-American police officer who has since retired, and he said, you know, you all just need to hang tough. Don't, just hang tough. It was like there is a waiting game, and they wait you out until your resources are all depleted, and then you're going to jail. I think not. You know, but again, that was our gift, is that God had given us a home and people who loved us with money and, you know, our attorney. It's crazy.
So in the end?
Well, in the end.
They dropped the charges?
Yes. They finally dropped the charges a year and a half later, about 18 months later, 19 months later. They just dropped the charges, and it was with no fanfare. Like, you know, his name was in the newspaper when they arrested him. His name wasn't in the newspaper when they let him go, you know, when they dropped the charges. You know, and he lost a scholarship. He had been able to get that scholarship based on his SAT scores. Well, when the SAT people or the scholarship people found out that he had this charge against him, they retracted the scholarship. Yes. And so, you know, my husband, who was a very ingenuity, he has lots of ingenuity. What do you call it?
Ingenuity.
Yes. I can't hardly say that. Well, he was ingenious enough to say, we gave all your college money to the police department, so you're going to Job Corps, you know, which really did. So he went to Job Corps and in Utah. We made him get out of Columbia, get out of Missouri. He just needed a fresh start. He was depressed. He was angry. We were all angry, you know, and it was affecting all of us. And so he went to Utah where he got a welding degree, and then he went to the Navy, where he is currently getting his degree in aeronautic engineering. And again, by the grace of God, he's loving it. But that was 11 years ago. So he's, you know, had to work his way back up. And thankfully, you know, again, the grace of God.
And everybody, like you said, everyone doesn't have the resources, everyone has the support system.
Right.
People who will hang in there. And
yes. And everybody knew that, no, not him, not Garrett, you know. If it was another son, maybe Ithamar, or, you know, we might have been like, uh-oh. You know, but we knew this son would not do anything
so
like that.
So what do you think the point of this was?
I think because my organization that I was
pushing them.
Yes, we were pushing them. Community Link was established as an LLC under my name. Uh-huh. And so they could look it up and say, you know, and then how do you get people, you know, when really I'm not, I mean, you.
Well, we've said, I think I told you there are many people who won't even do these recordings because they're afraid that there will be retaliation.
Well, there may be, but so can't anybody, I'm like, the Lord is my keeper. The Lord is my shade upon my right hand. The sun may, I mean, really, we are not going to allow intimidation to prevent the story from being told. And this was 11 years ago,
that's just
2003.
Why would, if they find possession of marijuana in the police call, why did they do drug tests right away?
Yeah.
Because
they would have told him, like, that
he was free. They would not do, I mean, there were so many things we were like, just go ahead and do a lie detector test. Go ahead and do a blood test. Go ahead and, you know, do those things that will exonerate him. And they would not. For whatever reason, they were like, it's inadmissible in court. Well, do it anyway. You know, we want you to, they were really trying to get us to just admit to guilt, you know, even though we're innocent, which would give him a record, and then he would not be able to join the Navy or go to Job Corps or, you know, be involved in any federally funded activity.
And itself is a crime.
Exactly.
If
you have a felony, even if you're innocent, you are suffering because you cannot have any federally funded resources, and you cannot vote to change the way this law is. I mean, there's just so many discrepancies, inequities. Well, it is part of the Mason-Dixon line, you know, which in the past has been very racially motivated. Columbia is definitely in the belt of the Ku Klux Klan, and, you know, I mean, if you look at the history of Columbia and how Sharp End, I don't know if you all researched how they kind of took over Sharp End and put all the urban renewal activities up. Well, that was, you know, purposefully done to disintegrate the African American community and the strength of having businesses and being able to, you know, provide for our own. But by the grace of God, you know, there's still hope. I mean, that's really one thing that I have to, you know, as I go through this and as I see how things are not equitable and how, you know, the enemy does try to get you, to try to, you know, get you to stop doing what you're doing that's going to benefit, you know, God, or is going to bring people to love, or going to help someone, you know, feel better about their life. If the enemy sees you doing that and then they can stop it, then they've succeeded. So I beg your pardon. You're not going to steal my joy. You're not going to take my children. You know, and that has been my experiences. Even when they try, you know, they don't succeed. Absolutely. You still have your joy. You still, for some reason, people started giving us money. And I didn't even know they loved us that much. You know, and they were like, here, take this, help your son. You know, so they were helping us, even people who we didn't know very well. And again, the attorney, you know, could have been crooked because they were here in Columbia. We had to get an attorney that was here in Columbia so that the public defender, is that, or whoever, the AD.
Prosecuting attorney.
Yes, the prosecuting attorney would only speak to a local attorney. And it was very expensive, but the local attorney that we just happened to choose, by the grace of God, was not having it. You know, she was, her name was Kay. She's like part of, I can't remember the name of it, but she was so good. And she, you know, even has called me a couple times and said, now give me the name to, because she's referring people to Job Corps. She's referring people to, you know, get what they need in spite of a limited resource as far as money. So, Kay, I wish I could remember. She's been, she was an awesome assistant at the time. Let me see if I forgotten anything. Okay. Like I said, that happened in 2003 in April. You know, again, our story has a happy ending. And, you know, that's really what I want people to understand, is that even when you're attacked, I beg your pardon, it's not the end of the story. Don't give up. Don't agree to anything that you didn't do. You know, don't allow. And tell people, because if we hadn't shared it, then we would be in that island, you know, totally surrounded by negativity and probably sunk. But because we were willing to share and, you know, tell our children to share, nobody's gonna, because they did say, well, if you agree, you know, we'll drop the charges, but you have a gag order. No. Do you know what a gag order is? Where you can't talk about it to anybody. Mm-mm. We called the police immediately. I mean, called the press immediately and said, they dropped the charges. This is what, you know, so you can Google, you know, and probably be able to find this story, because we were very verbal. And thankfully, you know, I think it helped us heal to be able to talk about it. Because some people, you know, they just keep it a secret, and, you know, that secrecy can tear on your inside. Everything. And you don't realize how much it affects you until you're, you know, in the
experience.
Yes. Or having to relive it, you know, because I really didn't realize how much it affected my son's life until we started talking about how he dealt with it, you know, and he was depressed, you know, and his friends were teasing him. Man, you got arrested. He's like, you know, I'm thankful that he was strong enough to stand up to them and say, you know, you don't know the story. But if he had a weak mind, or, you know, been easily influenced, it could have pushed him to drugs or alcohol or, you know, anything negative.
They think I did it already, so I might as well.
Right. And a lot of kids succumb to that kind of negativity. Well, you're going to call me a liar anyway. I'm just going to go lie. Well, you accuse me of stealing. That does not help. We're not going to try to add fuel to their fire. We're going to, you know, take the high road. What did Michelle Obama say? When they go low, we're going higher. I love that. And it's not easy, because, you know.
It's your child.
It's your child. I'm so thankful it worked out. If my child would have went down, I probably would have been in jail for, you know, hurting somebody. Because, nah, you're going to have to pay. But vengeance is mine, you know, and I do see how God, I don't know if you are aware what happened to Frank Bain, but he ain't there no more.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's gone. Randy Bain. Yeah, he's been gone.
Yeah, Randy Bain. Mm-hmm. So, you know, my experience every time is when the enemy tries to attack me, the person who the enemy's using usually gets, and I don't have to do anything. I'm like, okay, Lord, go ahead, do what you want. Because vengeance is his, not mine. And my job is to stay peaceful and try to treat people in love, even though you're, you know, smiling in my face, trying to stab me in the back.
Wow.
I know. I'm glad it's a good story, because, you know, I'm glad it turned out well, because it is very sad that it even happened. It's very, you know, it does depress you when you think that this, if it happened to us, it happened to, and how many people are in jail or in prison?
And if it's a single mom who's too tired to do this and, you know, doesn't have any money.
Right.
And the kid's life's run.
Absolutely. And I'm sure that's happened many, 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 many times.
It's like my grandma always said, be careful who you hang out with.
It's true.
Because, like, if it was his son, if he caught somebody who was doing drugs, both of them, like, even he doesn't, he was going to be also the drug person.
Like, it's true.
It was going to be
It would be negative toward him.
Mm-hmm. That's why my mom said, never give somebody a ride. If you don't
know. She's right. As sad as that is, you know, and my son was helping somebody, you know, but he was in the car by himself when they pulled him over. It's just, Just sad, just very sad. But you know what? This is what America is built on. It's not new. I remember when I was 5 years old and my father was in the Air Force and we were traveling from, again, I'm five, so this is kind of one of my first memories. And we were traveling from Arizona to California and somebody had given us some food. And my father was a minister, and so somebody had given, and my mom had, they had 10 kids when it was all said and done. But at this time, I was five, so we probably had, I'm fourth from the top. So we probably had like maybe 7 kids. And so somebody had given my mom and dad some food for them to travel with, and the food was infested with roaches. And so we were traveling in Arizona, and it was hot. And so these little red little roaches started coming out of this dish that they had given my mom. And we were like, they were everywhere in our car. And so I was born in 1958. And so 59, 60, 61, 62, 63. So it was 1963. And my mom and dad could not go to the gas station, which is right across the highway. I didn't know why. So we went to this side of the road place. It was just and dad went to the gas station and got some bug spray, and came, and we would not get back in that car. We were screaming and hollering, jumping up like banshees. It wasn't until we were later on, older, that my mom said we could not go to that gas station safely. It was in the middle of the night. And so we had to do what we had to do, and you all were making noise, you were getting ready to wake people up. We were just, there was just so much, that my mom and dad had to deal with. I was five, and we got the lesson. We got the talk then, it's like, you cannot go in everybody's store just because you think it's, and just because we need it, we're gonna have to wait till the morning. And, and it was just, don't look people in the face. Even, if they speak to you, you hold your head down. And then my mom, because she was raised in Kansas City, Kansas. And so she didn't like it. And so she would say, when they're looking at you, you hold your head down. But when you're, talking about them, or she would just give us, ways to feel empowered, even though we had to conform to those Jim Crow norms, really, Jim Crow. Back then.
And yeah, that would be really hard. How do you teach your kid to be proud?
Especially one like me. Absolutely. And I'm mouthy. I'm like, why we got in the, how come we can't look at them? They're looking at us. And I'm five and my eyes shine, so people think I'm cute. but my mom was like, well, when they're looking at you, do not look back. I'll tell you about it later. It was just, but we got through it. And I think, that's part of the reason why African-American people are so strong mentally, because we did have to, overcome things which we knew were not fair, but you still had to keep making a living. You still had to keep growing your children. You still had to keep loving your family and being involved. You can't just, your innate self says, well, let me just, retreat into my own little, but that's not how you do life if you want to change things. And so we still had to stay involved and, smile when you felt like crying. I've been there, and sometimes I cry through my tears. I mean, I cry through my smile, so there is no easy method to handle it. You just do what you have to do.
And it's not like it's over either.
It's not over. It's
Jim Crow's not here, but every day.
Jim Crow could come back.
And you experience things anyway, every day. Some sort of a microaggression, some sort of slight, some sort of look or comment that says you're not good enough.
Absolutely.
From people who are white.
And you have to raise your children to hear that and ignore it. When you're in high school, you teach your children to listen to what the high school counselor says and then take it above and beyond. Go and research for yourself. You tell your children in sports to, even though the coach is telling you to hang back a little bit because his star player's over here, you do what you're called to do. If you feel like you have a line, you have a shot, you have the ability, Just do it, and you may have to say you're sorry later, my bad, but ask for forgiveness, not permission. You know, that's how we were learned. That's how we were taught to overcome, you know, the things that were not fair, because it's not going to change, but you don't have to stand up for, you don't have to stand for it. I think my turn is, I'm getting a little self-conscious.
Oh, you're getting self-conscious.
There's a few more questions I had, if you don't mind.
Not at all.
In 2003, you said this happened in 2004. What was the atmosphere for the war on drugs, specifically crack cocaine? What was the environment like at that point?
It was epidemic. We were learning a lot about how especially crack cocaine had infiltrated the community, our community, and the media was just really talking a lot about how it was prevalent in our community, now that I think about it. Wow, that's interesting. Because sometimes I think, you know, the media plays a part in all of this. It's just like, why you want it? Because, you know, I mean, they're talking about who got arrested for what. Very rarely do they put the pictures of Caucasian people on the news when they're just flashing black people's picture, even if they're alleged, you know. And so, yeah, now that you mention it, crack cocaine was being talked about a lot in that time frame. But again, my son, he's so green. He's like, what is it? I don't know. Why are you pointing at me? I'm so glad he didn't touch it.
Yeah.
Again, the
if
Lord.
If he didn't touch it,
he would be under the jail.
You and
there's
no way you can't say it.
No. Right.
And if it was me, it's your hand, friend.
Right.
It's yours. You can't deny it.
Right.
It's good thing I did.
I know. I just trust that God was just preventing him from.
Did he know not to touch it? Or
no, we had never talked to him about that.
Wow, so that was just...
Right, we didn't think we had to with him, mm-hmm. You know, because we didn't think that would ever be something he would be confronted with, by the police especially, you know, but no. Sure. Any other questions?
Absolutely. If you would, the scholarship that your son was under review for?
Yes.
What was the name of that?
Lynn. He's always wanted to be an aeronautic engineer. When he was a kid, he wanted to be a biological engineer. Biological engineer? Anyway, something to do with water. I still have a little picture that he drew that something with water. And so we knew that he wanted. So he wanted to go to tech school. He didn't want to go to college. And he had been involved with 4-H and a lot of technical. He knew how to, he had built robots and he was very good at technology. And so he was slated to go to Lynn Tech in Lynn, Missouri. And they had given him, I think it was like $8,000. It wasn't a full scholarship, but it was significant. And he was going to go and stay on campus there, and he was slated to leave to go there in September. And this happened in April.
And, I mean, as far as this, that was like kind of a private scholarship the school offered, or was that from a different organization?
It was from Lynn Tech. We had been there. We had gone to like a open house, and so we had been there and reviewed what they wanted to present, and then we had made application, and they rewarded his application with an invitation to come and a scholarship if your SATs were high in his work, because he studied for him.
And what was the score?
Pardon me?
What was the score?
His SAT score? I asked him that too. I don't remember. He said he doesn't remember. But it was high enough to get a scholarship. He did, you know, the scholarship was awarded and then revoked when they read in the newspaper that he had been arrested for crack cocaine. What can you do? We find another, my mom used to say, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. You know, you find another angle, you find another option. And thankfully my husband had experience with Job Corps, and Job Corps did serve him very well. He needed to get out of Columbia. He needed to go to Utah, where he was surrounded, yes, by, you know, the God's green earth, and it changed his heart. It helped him to heal. Yeah, he's a good guy.
You know, that's the thing. it's no wonder people do get mad and mouth off, and you know, what do cops expect after, you know?
Well, I was just looking online today. Yeah. And there was a lady, and she's a social worker. It sounds like this just happened like yesterday or today. And she was a social worker, and he was telling her to, anyway, she ended up calling, I can't remember how. She was standing up in front of her own car, and she called the police because his attitude was adversarial. And she called 911 and said, I have one of your officers over here being disrespectful, and I'm not trying to fuck with him. So can you all send somebody else over? Because I want to talk to somebody else. Right now, he is not even communicative. You know, and so she was kind of talking, and by the time she was, like, trying to finish the conversation, he wouldn't even let her finish the conversation with 911. He just started, you know. And so now she's fighting, and so she got arrested for resisting arrest. And you didn't even arrest her. But she's resisting arrest. You know, why wouldn't he just let her finish the conversation with 911 operators? That just does not make sense, that he didn't want to wait. That was it. He didn't want to wait for her to, because maybe they might have sent somebody to, you know, calm him down, or, you know, I don't know. Right. Mediate. Right. But so that just happened, like, I saw it this morning. So it might have happened yesterday.
Today?
Yes. I saw it just recently, like, it was probably noon today.
Was she black?
Yes.
If it's a black person, it's always going to be, oh, they resist arrest, but in reality, they did not.
Marat was just scared.
And, you know, yes, I mean, I know if I got pulled over today, I would be, like, tentative. You know, and usually I'm jovial. What's the problem? Yes, sir. I don't know, but I would be like, Yes, sir. You know, and you can't help but be on guard.
Oh, right, but I think the police use that excuse about being afraid.
That they're afraid?
Yeah.
I think police are afraid. I mean, okay,
well,
think about
it. I agree, but I think they play it up.
Yes, they use it to their advantage. Absolutely. But I can understand their fear because... You know,
if you're in a bad neighborhood, they might fear for their life, and that's when they're so opening. Even the person might not be carrying any weapon on them, but they might just feel, oh, here's something, you might touch something. It's a guy you were going for, you're dead. I mean, even if that's not what you're going for, that's what they're going to think of.
Right.
If you're dead, you can't, there's no witness, there's only you rely on somebody. A bywalk or somebody to just say, this is what I'm recording something, this is what I saw. Like, but the person is already dead, you can't bring back the life.
Or it's true.
You can't do nothing. Just.
So I can understand their fear because they have, you know, pretty much facilitated, you know, some of these actions that are being brought to them. But you don't add fuel to the fire by... You know,
and they do things. My cousin is a cop in Vegas, and one of his buddies was killed, and all these cops have his badge number tattooed on there, and that justifies their fear over and over and over again. They use that to justify their fear.
Mm-hmm. By killing somebody.
They do it to keep it, like, on his sleeve.
So maybe I should tattoo, you know, my son.
Right.
And I'll be fearful too, so we just all be fearful, you know, hurting each other.
It's wrong to justify anything he does, and it's, you know, that could have been my boy.
It could be anyone.
Right.
Anyone, husband.
And my thought is also, you know, look at the history of America. Look at the history of different countries that have enslaved or, you know, degraded, discriminated against, and how eventually it can come back around and bite you. You know, I mean, I'm looking at, thinking about how the Germans, you know, went through the Holocaust and all of that, and how now, you know, people are seeking out and killing those Nazi soldiers who, so yes, there's going to be some fear involved if you continue to hurt people, and you know, what's done in the dark going to be brought in the light, and what is that, karma?
Yeah, but so the weird thing about it is he's using the death of a friend to make his friends scared. To make them afraid,
and by doing whenever they come across a black person.
Is the one that be here for the most. It's open by the all your heart. There's nothing in there.
How can we change that? You know, I mean, it really has.
It's
the chickens come home to roost.
Have you heard that? The community has to speak out. If they don't speak out, then who's going to know there's something that's going on like that? You know, how could we such a cool?
I want you to come over here and sit by me, because we need to have you on. On video also, because that's a good point. And you know, to me, it's like, that's, we gotta talk about solutions. Not just, you know, the negativity of it, but what's the, how can we resolve?